Good evening, friends, colleagues, esteemed panelists, office bearers of Chess Council of India. At the outset, I thank the Chess Council of India for this wonderful opportunity to be the moderator of this mega event, aptly named as Fungal Holi. Welcome to you all to the Mecca online panel discussion on the fungal epidemic in association with the raging COVID pandemic. Funguses and fungal diseases are common and were here from time immemorial. But why the surge in COVID-19? Hypoxia, hyperglycemia, acidic medium, high iron levels, decreased phagocytic activity of leukocytes, coupled with prolonged hospitalization with or without mechanical ventilation. And also, many people say voriconazole prophylaxis also said to be the risk factor. And corticosteroids were implicated as one of the major culprits. True, but is it exaggerated? Because we were using corticosteroids for many a condition, starting from rheumatological diseases to interstitial lung diseases, like anything on a day-to-day basis. Heavy doses, millions of people are getting steroids. But still, we didn't see this much fungal infections anywhere in the world, not only in India, anywhere in the world. Then why this surge? Is COVID or corticosteroid the real culprit? That is the question we have to answer. And another issues are there. Candida and aspergillus are top in the list if you took any statistics from the rest of the world. But mucormycosis ranked first in India and also in Indian subcontinent. In fact, 80% of all the cases of mucormycosis were reported from Indian subcontinent, and the chance of 80 times higher prevalence when compared to the rest of the world. So that is also very, very important. Who is the real villain? Corticosteroid or COVID? That is the question. Then there are confusions, controversies, starting from the diagnosis, how to treat, what is the prognosis, who should treat. All these are very, very important. And we today at the Chess Council of India will discuss all these issues. Every point we try to discuss. And we have esteemed panelists of national repute with us to unravel this mycotic mystery. Let us see who are the panelists. And as moderator, I have great pleasure to introduce my fellow panelists. They are rich in experience, clinical acumen, and also academic pursuits. And first, I wish to introduce Dr. Rupesh Kumar Singh. He is a consultant ENT surgeon. He is our guest consultant ENT surgeon, Bhagavan Mahavir Medica Super Specialty Hospital, Ranchi. Dr. Rupesh Kumar Singh, please. Dr. Rupesh Kumar Singh. And second, our young talent, Dr. Atrey Maha Gangopadhyay, consultant pulmonologist, Pulse Hospital, Ranchi. And moreover, he is the East Zone Governor of Chess Council of India. Then Dr. Ashutosh Gupta is there. He's the consultant pulmonologist, respiratory care center, Sri Janvalsaya Hospital, Civil Lines, Saket Hospital, Prayagraj. Dr. Ashutosh?
Yes.
Then Dr. Neil Thakur, consultant intensivist, pulmonary and critical care physician, Vadodara, Gujarat. Sir, welcome you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Then Dr. Hiranappa B. Udinur, senior consultant in pulmonary critical care and sleep medicine, Columbia Asia and Baptist Hospitals, Hebbal, Bengaluru. Welcome, sir. Then Dr. Gurpreet Singh, senior consultant and head of pulmonary and critical care medicine, SPS Hospital, Ludhiana. So as the brochure clearly states, we have people from Kerala to Ludhiana, Ranchi, Bengaluru, and many, many parts. And apart from this, we have other backbones are with us. Our President, Dr. Narendra Methukulu, CCI National President, Dr. Ravi Doshi is the National General Secretary of Chess Council of India, And last but not least, our founder, president, and secretary, chairman, trustees, Dr. N. H. Krishnaji, and my own colleague, my own friend, Dr. Narayana Pradeva. I welcome you all on behalf of Chess Council of India and on behalf of this webinar meeting. And as we discussed earlier, initially there will be a case, an interesting case scenario that is presented by Dr. Hiranappa. Over to Dr. Hiranappa for the case presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, CCI team, for inviting me to this panel on discussion on fungal pneumonia. And I would also like to thank Dr. Shahjahan for having a beautiful introduction. And I would follow it with a beautiful case presentation and make it interesting for you. Thank you.
I'm going to discuss an interesting case of lung disease in a post-COVID state, which is really caused havoc. And we are all into this fungal holy discussion of the color of the fungus and all. And one prototype so that our discussion will be streamlined. So I happen to see a case with 55-year-old and with uncontrolled diabetes with HbA1c of around 9, and she has recovered from the COVID illness with use of steroids, remdesivir, and anticoagulants, and almost 1 to 1.5 months with multiple antibiotics, with persistent cough and sputum. She presented to us with sputum AFP being negative and HRCT showing cavity, and they are planning to start anti-TB drugs. For that, they are referred here. When they came to us, and we got an X-ray done, which is showing the cavity, which is thick wall cavity in the upper lobe, with lower lobe showing the collapse, and we are not able to visualize the right cardiac border and elevated dome of diaphragm. It's the right lower lobe collapsing right upper lobe cavity, probably a main bronchus pathology. That was our suspicion. Then we went ahead with a CT scan of the chest with contrast. As you can see, the CT scan airways are visible and right upper lobe cavity is there. There's no evidence of a classical fungus. And when you see a lower lobe, it is obstructed. We can see the mucus plug, which is going with a glowing finger-like appearance, and the left lower lobe cavity is also visible. So this is the case, and the differentials for us was more of tuberculosis and multiple cavities. Since it's multiple cavity, tuberculosis is one differential diagnosis, and right lower lobe collapse, we should try to explain, and the mucus plug and distal lung is okay. We thought fungal aspergillus ABPA is a possibility, and sometimes tuberculosis and secondary infection is a possibility when the bacterial is a possibility. So this was, there were no classical evidence of fungus. Then we went ahead with a bronchoscope, and I was sorry for it, and there's no pictures which are really in a non-video bronchoscope on the website. And fiber optic bronchoscopy, upper lobe, there were a lot of purulent secretion, left lung was okay. We have sent for a ball for cultures and ball for tuberculosis and galactomannan and other fungal cultures also. And the lower lobe obstruction was seen. There was whitish, multiple mucus plug, which was difficult to remove. We took multiple biopsies from that side. We are not able to reobstruct the total right lower lobe. And we thought we send all the tests. And with the pending reports, tuberculosis and everything was, we just started on antibiotics with the anti-pseudomonal cover, ball cultures grew, but the histopathology, they were taking time for it. Since galactomannan was positive, we are pretty clear that it is ABPA, probably NVSU, ABPA required the surgery, and the fungal culture abated, biopsy was abated. So then came, we are planning to start oriconazole or itraconazole based on the findings of that, with galactomannan being positive. And histopathology, we went and we discussed with them, and they were very pretty clear. And she showed the first one, the slides, and this is the slide which is a high power microscope showing a slender looking septate. We can see a septate, and they are slender and making these acute angles. And this is classical of aspergillosis. That's what she meant to say, and we are pretty certain. But when you look at the other slides and all, she was saying, wait for a minute, we have a mucus also in this. As you can see, the mucus, your branchings, which are acute, which is the right angle or obtuse angles. You can see in the third slide, it's a ribbon-like appearances. They are non-septate and broader in appearance. She said, we have aspergillus and mucor in this case. Then I said it was not looking black or not looking like brownish, and this is looking like white only. So I'm just mentioning the color. So this, she said she is pretty sure that she has a food fungus in that. And we said our way of management will change. And she confirmed this from PA stain that definitely we have both fungus, aspergillus and mucor in this histopathology. We have got it from endobronchial obstruction. Now it is a therapeutic challenge and treating them with amphotericin, because amphotericin cover for aspergillus and mucor microphos. We have started liposomal amphotericin. We thought around 6 or 7 days of liposomal amphotericin has gone to this patient. And cumulative dose, we can give up to 3 grams or 5 grams. We can go up to that. Now she has received a cumulative around 600 mg. We have started ceftazidime for pseudomonal cover. We didn't add etraconazole or voriconazole because amphotericin covers. After 6 or 5 days, she is going to take a long haul with central line and all. We discussed with this thing how we can deobstruct the lower lobe. We thought of doing only a rigid bronchoscopy and remove it, and so that we can save you the antibiotics for longer duration and see. But suppose if it is fungal and number of days of admission, we can as well do a surgery. Surgery, they are ready to do the right upper lobectomy. The problem is the lower lobe can be salvaged, and the pneumonectomy is something which is too much too. And since the distal lung is normal, we try to conserve it. So our plan was to plan to remove the right upper lobe and do in the same setting rigid bronchoscope and deobstruct. If you are unable to do, we can actually do a bronchoplasty. That is a plan. And that's the interesting case for a fungus. That's why fungal pneumonias manifest like that. It has a challenging because surgical role is there. This looks complex initially, but as you keep on managing, we will get solutions. But the discussions are important. So complex problems will have simple solutions. Let's hear from the experts how exactly to manage fungal pneumonias. Whatever we have thought in managing fungal pneumonia, this pandemic has taught in managing fungal pneumonia is huge. And let's hear from the experts and their inputs. Let's hear from them. Thank you.
Good evening, friends. I welcome all of you on behalf of Chest Council of India for today's seminar on fungal holi. And I'm going to discuss about diagnostic modalities in fungal infection. I will take you through a few of the cases which are real cases which we have diagnosed and treated in our hospital. For diagnostic purposes, we definitely need a clinical specimen. The important thing is we should be able to take the specimen from the diseased site. So it can be a sputum examination if the patient is having fungal pneumonia. Nasal swab or hard pellet swab can be taken if we are suspecting rhinosinusitis related fungal infection. Or we can do bronchoalveolar lavage to diagnose fungal infections. It's very easy to do KOH mount, and microbiologist can tell us about whether there is any hyphae, pseudo hyphae, septate hyphae or aseptate hyphae, which I will be able to discuss how we can diagnose these types of fungal infections. If we are suspecting invasive fungal infection, then 1,3-beta-D glucan assay can be helpful. We can do galactomannan in serum or bile for suspected aspergillus infection. For pneumocystis, xerophysi pneumonia, which happens mainly in AIDS patient, we can do Grogot Gomori stain. Blood for fungal culture or tissue cultures are helpful, but we know these samples or cultures are going to take time. And we know that fungal infections are fatal infections, and we have to diagnose them very, very fast and treat very fast so that we can save the lives. We know invasive candidiasis can be fatal. We know mucor mycosis can be fatal. So it's very, very important to diagnose these diseases or these infections very fast. Other investigations which can be done are in the form of serology, like immunodiffusion. We have complement fixation. We have enzyme amino assays. We have PCR methods, but again, molecular methods are evolving, and still we don't have these types of investigations which are handy or which are very, very sensitive or specific. Histopathology is very, very important, but again, we need to take these samples invasively, maybe surgically or maybe bronchoscopically or other methods. Radiology is very, very important, especially for sinusitis, fungal sinusitis. Here we can see right maxillary sinusitis with marked osseous thinning and erosion of floor of right orbit with the right orbital soft tissue swelling, which is clearly seen. And this patient was diagnosed to have mucormycosis. I'm going to present few cases which are very, very tricky. This was pre-COVID era, 75-year-old diabetic who presented to us with fever of 2 weeks. On chest x-ray, we can clearly see inhomogeneous opacity in left upper and mid zone, reported as likely infective etiology. So here, most of the time we think about bacterial infection or sometimes tuberculosis. CT scan of this patient revealed areas of interstitial septal thickening with ground glass haze, giving crazy paving pattern with airspace consolidation, quasi bacterial pneumonia. So this patient has undergone bronchoscopic BAL and TBLP as he was not responding to usual antibiotics. His BAL gram stain was negative, AFP smear was negative, aerobic culture was also negative, fungal smear was negative. And here we have done transbronchial lung biopsy from left upper lobe, and it was reported as bits of necrotic tissue with aseptate branched fungal hyphae. This is the histological picture, and you can appreciate fruiting bodies of mucormycosis. And we diagnose it as pulmonary mucormycosis, which was very unusual. Another case, 30-year-old diabetic presented with fever, cough, and breathlessness with very high TLC count. And again, we can see chest x-ray, which was showing bilateral pneumonia. Here, the patient was in ICU. He was critically sick, hemodynamically unstable. His CT scan revealed bilateral cavitating lesions. This patient was not improving with the usual antibiotics. So we decided to do bronchoscopy on this patient. And when we have put a bronchoscope, we could see a white, hard, mass-like spiral growth over the carina going into the right mainstream bronchus, and it was totally obstructing the right main bronchus. You can see we took bronchoscopic endobronchial biopsy from this lesion, and it came out to be aseptate hyphae, wide angled irregular branching pattern, characteristic of mucormycosis. This patient was put on antifungal drug amphotericin B. Another case, 30-year-old female, which is a usual thing, who presented in OPD with care of hemoptysis. She gives history of treatment of tuberculosis in childhood, and her CT scan revealed air crescent sign. You can see fungal ball in right upper lobe. Here, when we have done bronchoscopy, it revealed large fungal ball in right upper lobe. So this actually tells us that doing an invasive procedure like bronchoscopy in these types of patients can clinch the diagnosis very fast. Here, the tissue which was taken by bronchoscopic biopsy revealed septate branched hyphae. This is first figure is BAL, that is bronchoalveolar lavage, and second one is biopsy. Septate branched fungal hyphae is characteristic of aspergillus. So this patient was diagnosed to have aspergilloma, and because of recurrent hemoptysis, this patient has undergone right upper lobe lobectomy. This is a recent case. A patient presented to us with fever, which was going on for last 3 weeks. He was treated for COVID-19 in the form of steroids and remdesivir. And later on, he presented to us with left upper lobe cavitating lesion. This was a CT scan which revealed left upper lobe cavitating lesion with lot of alveolar space opacities. He was put on IV antibiotics, but as he was not responding, bronchoscopy and bronchoscopic BAL revealed Candida glabrata. And fortunately, this Candida glabrata was sensitive to voriconazole. This patient is still under treatment with voriconazole and he is doing well on OPD basis. Another 54-year-old male patient post-COVID-19 who presented to us with cough, expectoration, breathlessness, fever with rigors and chills. Here again, you can see a large lung abscess which was involving the right lung. Here, the sputum revealed Pseudomonas fluorescens, but fungal smear for sputum also revealed aseptate fungal hyphae. So this is the importance of taking even a very easy sample like sputum, which revealed fungal hyphae, which were aseptate. And this patient was diagnosed to have mucormycosis and he was put on amphotericin B. This was the CT scan of this patient, which again revealed right lung abscess with the air leak. You can appreciate surgical emphysema in this patient. Another case who presented to us with fever, productive cough, decreased oral intake for 2 weeks. This patient was again treated for COVID-19 1 month back in the other hospital. He presented to us with consolidation in right upper lobe. His sputum was just showing budding yeast cells, but culture revealed aspergillus flavus. This patient was treated with voriconazole. He improved over time. He had UTI also, for which BJ stenting was done. This patient improved over 1 month's time. You can see consolidation in right upper lobe, which was aspergillus. So this patient had left pyelonephritis. He underwent DJR with the rhinoscopy to remove probable stone, which was the sample was taken and it revealed thread-like fluffy coverings involving whole of pelvis and all the calyces. So suboptimal rhinoscopy was done. Patient improved, went home, but later on this patient came back with again UTI, and this time it reveals fungal, which was aseptate as well as partially septate branch fungal hyphae. This patient actually underwent nephrectomy because he was not improving, and we got actually both aspergillus as well as mucormycosis in this patient. The nephrectomy tissue revealed mixed fruiting bodies of aspergillus as well as mucormycosis. So this patient has received voriconazole along with amphotericin B and posaconazole, and he is doing fine right now. So you can see aspergillus septate fungal hyphae as well as fruiting bodies of aspergillus and mucormycosis. This patient went left nephrectomy and he survived this fungal infection. So that is the importance of doing invasive investigation for these types of patients so that we can save them. Another patient, 64-year-old diabetic with fever, cough, breathlessness for 3 weeks. His CT scan revealed thick-walled cavitatory lesion in left lower lobe with loculated left moderate pleural effusion. Intercostal chest tube was inserted to drain fluid, which was actually neutrophilic predominant. This patient was on IV antibiotics, but he was not improving. So we decided to do thoracoscopy for this patient. So again, the importance of further invasive investigation like thoracoscopy in these patients. This is the CT scan picture which showed left lower lobe cavitating lesion. And this is the thoracoscopic view of the pleural cavity. I will show you the video also which was done during thoracoscopy. We have done thoracoscopy in our hospital only and we diagnose it as mucormycosis. The tissue taken revealed large areas of necrosis with many broad-based aseptic fungal hyphae consistent with morphology of mucormycosis. So this is the thoracoscopic view. You can see this bubbling thing is a lung, a necrotic lung, and the upper area is all pleural cavity, which was full of pus. So we took samples from this area, the lung tissue, which was all necrosed. You can see this one as black. One more video, small video. So you can see all this necrotic tissue. This was all fungal, that is mucormycosis. So histopathology reveals aseptic branch fungal hyphae characteristic of mucormycosis. I thank you all for giving me an opportunity to discuss about diagnostic investigations for fungal infections. Thank you.
So thank you, Dr. Gurpreet, for sharing the nice cases to us. Really enlightening. Both of you presented well. Now the real panel discussion start, the question and answer session. People are waiting for that. And the first question I wanted to ask is to our young chap, Dr. Atre. We know there are black, white, green, yellow like that, and we do not know when it reach VIBGO. You just tell us, what is black, white, green, yellow, etc., etc.? Because anyway, even though it is a misnomer scientifically, millions of people say like that. So we have to explain what it is, please.
Whenever we are fighting a complicated disease, we must try to simplify things for the benefit of everyone. Fungi historically were always known for their color. Whenever we used to go to an excursion, picnic, we used to see all these colorful things growing. So basically, when we come to the pathological fungi also inside our human body, automatically our mind goes to the color. So let's come to black fungus, which is probably the most talked about term in recent news. Black fungus commonly refers to mucor and accompanying mucor alleles, anything in the mucor alleles. And why black? Due to the tissue invasion, they basically invade the blood vessels, causing obstruction in the blood vessels, leading to a relatively avascular area and a tissue necrosis, giving that black color to the tissue. So that goes for black fungus. Then what can be white fungus? White is the name given to Candida. Why? Initially, when Candida starts, then what happens? When Candida starts, white patches grow on the skin, mucous surfaces, inner surface of cheek, tongue, angle of the mouth. So that's why white fungus. Green, Aspergillus is green. And why the color? Because in culture media, it produces this peculiar green colored colonies. Yellow is a misnomer. Basically, mucor or our notorious black fungus is sometimes known to cause pus production due to secondary infection by bacteria. And that will give rise to that pus or yellow. So yellow fungus is basically that black mucor with a secondary bacterial infection giving rise to pus. So these are the four colors currently which we encounter in the human body in fungal infection. Over to you.
Thank you, Atri, for the simple explanation. And also you justified it also. Thank you very much. The next question is to Dr. Gurpreet. What are the risk factors for developing this fungal pneumonia in this COVID era? And also, when we should suspect, you discussed something, but when we should suspect fungal infection in COVID and post-COVID stage? Dr. Gurpreet, please. You are muted.
Unmute yourself.
Fungi normally does not cause infection in...
It is not audible, Dr. Gurpreet. Some issue?
Move to the next question. Let him rejoin.
If we will go to the next question. My question is to Dr. Neil Thakur. What are the clinical picture and also radiological picture pattern of black fungus pneumonia? This is so-called black fungus pneumonia.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible?
Yes.
No issue. So for the black fungus, basically, first of all, as I think sir was mentioning, that before we start with any clinical features, we have to find an at-risk population. So in an at-risk population for mucormycosis, if any patient is a diabetic, that would be the number one risk factor, even in the pre-COVID era, as well as with COVID-associated mucormycosis. In both these situations, diabetes as well as diabetic ketoacidosis is the number one risk factor. And if a patient comes to us with a history of diabetes or uncontrolled sugars, or for any reason has had a new onset diabetes also post-COVID, they should be suspected of having mucormycosis. We should keep that in mind when we are looking at the patient. Second would be any patient who is immunocompromised. If a patient has a low immunity, is on chronic steroids, is a post-transplant patient, or is due to any chronic problem, his immunity is suppressed, or is on any long-term immunosuppressants. These are the patients where we should keep mucormycosis in mind. Coming to the respiratory features is number one, if a patient will have a high-grade fever with some history of cough with hemoptysis. Now, hemoptysis could be frank blood clots, or it would be cough with blood-tinged sputum. So any worsening in the respiratory symptoms, which is rapid onset, characterized by breathlessness, cough, chest pain. If the patient is having systemic mucormycosis, which is associated, he will have a characteristic number of ENT complaints, which will be discussed by Dr. Rupesh. But otherwise, if there is any altered consciousness, if the patient has a neurological involvement, might have seizures, if any photophobia, persistent headache. Now, these have been evaluated extensively, even in the pre-COVID era, and these are the risk factors. And in the post-COVID era, when we see that there have been studies and recent papers also which have been published, one of them being in the Diabetes and Metabolic Syndrome Journal in May 2021. So there they studied that in a group of around 100 cases of COVID-associated mucormycosis, which have been reported, majority came from India, majority were males, and either with active or a recent history of COVID. Again, diabetics, most common population, the involvement involved the nose and the sinus in majority of the cases. And that's why we have to keep this in mind, because this has been recently studied in COVID-associated mucormycosis as well as previously before this. So these basically are the respiratory clinical features of mucormycosis. Now coming to the, the ENT features can be discussed by Dr. Rupesh.
You will get the opinion of Dr. Rupesh. He is eagerly waiting to answer actually.
Yes,
sir, what is your opinion regarding the radiological picture and as well as the ENT clinical picture in case of a suspected case of mucormycosis?
This is from me, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, Council of India and Dr. Sahaja sir and all panelists for listening me. from what I have learned from the patients. The thing is that what I learned from the patients till date, that mucormycosis per se is not very common. It always happens in very immunocompromised neutropenic patients with a lot of metabolic abnormality. But when the pandemic mucormycosis happens, then there must be some serious underlying medical conditions which is not being shown clearly. And when, as an ENT, we put an endoscope inside the nose of a patient who is a post-COVID mucor or post-COVID complaint of mucor, then we have to look very carefully that why it is unilateral or why it is bilateral and what are the main causes and what are the structure of the mucosa. When I see the patient initially, the patient come to me with a complaint of severe pain. Means the pain is like this, it's a short bursting pain, which may be recognized as a trigeminal neuralgic pain. Second, the patient presented with cavernous isolated thrombosis with complete ophthalmoplegia and maxillary sinus tenderness with some swelling. Then, as I also treat a COVID patient previously with my friend, and we both keep investigating all patients. So we have treated approximately more than 50 patients, and all patients has been examined endoscopically. All patients we have given acyclovir as a prophylactic treatment for 5 to 7 days. None of the patients have any post-COVID complications like mucormycosis, like any fungal infection to the chest, any fungal infection to the nose. The reason has sought me to clarify why this is happening. And from there, my all learning curves starts. Then the radiological feature, as we all know, in mucormycosis, a lot of things. The main thing is that before you proceed to the diagnosis, before you proceed to the radiological thing, you should have to know the etiology prior to that thing. And the etiology is that most of the patients have a dermatomal involvement of mucormycosis, either to the cutaneous lesion, means skin. The skin is involved only here. Then the question is why it is unilateral mucormycosis and why there is a dermatomal involvement of mucormycosis. Then the patient's has been investigated for herpes simplex virus because it is a most common, easily available ganglionic virus, which is available in trigeminal ganglion as well as in the cervical, other cranial nerves and other ganglion. So these patients have been reported to be positive with a very high titer of IgG, HSV1 and HSV2, both. Few patients are with IgM also, and all of them are being treated surgically with debridement. But along with that, I have given antifungal for few days, but most of the patient is not able to continue the antifungal, but they have continued the antiviral. The antiviral is given for 5 to 10 days, some patient with 14 days, with a dose of 500 acyclovir IV TDS to BID, depending on the patient's conditions and all the things. The patient recovered rapidly. What I see, sir, the mucosa, maxillary sinus mucosa, which is completely debrided due to vasculitis, has completely healed within 2 to 3 days. And that has given me the confirmation that if the maxillary branch of trigeminal, means V2, is involved, then it causes the same symptom. And if the ophthalmic division of trigeminal is involved, then it is likely to cause the ptosis with all the things. So the patient has made me to think this, because when I given acyclovir to all the patients, in spite of all antifungal, the patient recovered rapidly. And even after surgery, some patient has developed a spasm, means they are not able to open his mouth. He has developed a trismus. Then again, with thromboembolism also, in the supraorbital vein also. Then again, I have to start the same. And confirmation is through, sir, PCR, polymerase chain reaction, real time, from the pus, from the bone. Few patients have come positive with herpes simplex virus DNA. And after giving the dose of 7 doses of acyclovir, the patient is coming negative. And those who has a very high titer of IgG and IgM, the IgG has come down after giving acyclovir. The patient's clinical condition has improved. So my main concern here is, nose act as a defense, means organ, to prevent the fungal entry inside the body. The defense main thing is the production of nitric oxide inside the paranasal sinuses and mucociliary clearance. So this virus is acting, specifically acting on the mucosa vasculitis, which is decreasing the enosynthase enzyme to decrease the nitric oxide production first, which is causing easily available all the fungus material either in the paranasal sinus or either in the lung. So whenever we got any fungal infection in the lungs, sir, my thing is that we have to definitely sort the CTPNS to look for the vasculitis, to look for the mucosal thickening. It may be due to vasculitis. So you will not able to discriminate it whether the vasculitis. So endoscopy is required in that sense, along with patient clinical coordination, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Let me ask another issue. If you have any, if you don't have any ethical issues, what was the outcome of these 50 persons? Eager to know. 50 patients. Outcome.
Outcome of 50 patients treated with acyclovir, sir?
No. You said 50 cases of mucormycosis. Then what is the outcome of the patients?
Outcome of the patient is very important, sir. Outcome, I want to tell you that once I stop all medications and the patient has been on injection acyclovir either during treatment and post-treatment, the patient sugar level is getting under control and the glycosylated hemoglobin of most of the patient has decreased 2 to 3 level. Means it was initially...
Unsurveyed? All of the patients survived? How many survived?
No, all of them have survived, sir.
Okay, the very, very good data. Very good. Thank you. Thank you. So the next issue, thank you very much. The next question is to Dr. Hiranappa. What is the clinical and radiological presentation of aspergillosis in COVID?
Clinically, aspergillosis normally it doesn't cause infection in immunocompetent person. Our airways are going to clear it anyway. But it can present like a hypersensitive reaction. It can just be a sensitization to aspergillus. That can happen in an immunocompetent. That's the first presentation. It can present like flu-like illness. It may not germinate. You may see in the airway. Just seeing it in the airway doesn't mean anything. But the problem is this, clinical presentations, when you look at, when aspergillus are spores are suddenly inhaled, sometimes we can get asthma, allergic asthma-like reaction. It lacks like a trigger in an atopic individual. So when the fungal spores are exposed, they may get asthma-like symptoms, wheezing, and these kind of manifestations. We don't even know that it might be caused by aspergillosis. Because the airway temperature, the human body temperature is a good temperature for the aspergillus to germinate. So aspergillus is peculiarly unlike other fungus. It has two things which can do, which can cause one inflammation and one is infection and destructions. So one of the prototype which you have seen as a pulmonologist is apart from like hypersensitivity reaction like this and post-tubercular situations, it can have a saprophytic colonization. Means if you can, sometimes if you have a pre-existing cavity of tuberculosis or because of anything, so it can just form in the wall of the cavity and it can invade there. And they can come with Matthew Hemoptysis, and that is the presentation. We may go for a surgery as Dr. Gurupit case has presented that. That is one kind of presentation. Another thing which you come to investigations, but the risk factors are very, very important. The risk factors for aspergillus, the biggest risk factor to develop the aspergillus is sometimes neutropenia is the biggest risk factor. Neutropenia, neutrophils are required to engulf this aspergillus and drive away. So neutropenia and some CGD, those kind of things are the risk factors. Other things are the steroids, long-term use of steroids. And one is asthma itself is a risk factor on a long-standing asthmatics. And these people, when they are colonized long-standingly, and they may develop symptoms of ABPA. We can see all the stages of ABPA and the clinical manifestation. The X-ray can be absolutely normal. They can be, it's not visible every time. It may not make a radiological presentation. ABPA, where what happens, you know, it starts germinating in the airway and it can cause two reactions. One is the hypersensitivity reactions like this, inflammatory reactions. So that's why we give steroids in ABPA. So other thing is when it really germinates, it can have a invasion. When it starts to invade, then it is the problem. The invasion is directly linked to the net immune suppression which is there underlying in a patient. So if you see a post transplant, post stem cell transplant, post renal transplant, and one of the risk factor is post influenza also, there are a lot of aspergillosis. Now we are seeing, I don't know, our asthmatic patients are not taking regular inhalers and all. In last month, we have taken, I have not seen this many number of in ABPS, in 6 or 7 ABPS with a mucus plugs. So when in the airway, when it really germinates and increases the production of the mucus, and the mucus are really, really thick, this mucus plugging, and it can happen in the mucus plugging, you can see a glow in finger like appearances, or all these kind of appearances which like bronchiectasis like changes with a mucus plugging. You may sometimes mimic right upper lobe collapse and right lung collapse also. They can have, it may mimic like a malignancy. We see an endobronchial obstruction. When you see, I am very happy for the patient because it's not malignancy. When you take in a bronchoscopy and remove it, and we can see a Charcot-Ladle Christian, eosinophilia, and all those things can be proven on aspergillus. That's the presentation of ABPA. So usually they require an etraconazole or voriconazole, what Dr. Gurpreet has said. That is one manifestation of ABPA. And the other few manifestations, what you see is aspergillosis. What aspergillosis? We are familiar with ABPA. 70% of the patients are asthmatic background. Few are cystic fibrosis. And 30% non-asthmatic patients, we can get aspergillus. And the first thing of invasion is they can be airway invasive. When they are airway invasive, and what are the, I'm just correlating the symptoms with the radiology. Radiology is the first thing
we Dr. Hiranyappa, would you please brief? Because we have a lot many things to discuss. Please brief for this aspergillus.
We can get consolidations and tree in bud appearances. And there is something called as angio invasion. It causes a necrosis in the center. We can see a halo-like appearance. It's a classical of aspergillosis in an early stage. If it goes to a later stage, we get a cavitation and a crescent-like appearance in the CT scan, which is cavitating, or a reverse halo sign like picture can be seen. And if it is invasive aspergillosis, we know it requires, if it's really bad, the prognosis is bad, may require these are the various modalities of aspergillus presentations.
Thank you. This is a very vibrant topic. So I request all the panelists to be brief, because we have a lot many things to discuss. So the next issue we have to discuss is that to Dr. Ashutosh Gupta, what is the clinical and radiological presentation of white fungus?
Thank you, sir.
We have finished aspergillus. And what is the clinical presentation of white fungus?
Thank you, sir. Thank you for that introduction. And thank you to the CCI. For inviting my panelist. White fungus, that already told by Dr. Atri, it is Candida, or you can also say the aspergillus is also termed as white fungus, though it is a misnomer. So classical Candida infection of the thorax include basically empyema, tracheobronchial tree infection, and mediastinal infection. Candida pneumonia is usually a part of the candidemia, generally not infected lung exclusively. Though it is can infect from the aspiration, also the rare case of the aspiration pneumonia. The manifestation of Candida pneumonia include cough, dyspnea, and fever, and any worsening of pre-existing respiratory symptom can be a fungal pneumonia or fungal infection. Neurological features are usually non-specific, usually involve consolidation, cavitation, effusion sometimes, and sometimes multilobar consolidation. No specific particular features present for the Candida pneumonia.
Thank you. You said it. The high clinical suspicion is the most important.
Especially uncontrolled
diabetes. So the next issue we are going to discuss is a public concern. Could all COVID patients be worried about fungal pneumonia? First issue. Second, is it contagious? Many people are asking, is it contagious? Or how it is transmitted? The question is to Dr. Gurpreet. Sir, please.
Yeah, see, the spread of mucormycosis, especially black fungus, as Dr. Rupesh has said, probably there is some invasion of the skin or soft tissue, which has gone into the sinuses, then to the lungs. Regarding transmission, it is not spread by patient to patient, definitely. But the source of mucormycosis can be, it can be patients who got discharged from the hospital, went home, there may be a mucor in their washrooms, mucor in their sinks, mucor in the walls of their bedrooms. So these are basically spores which are there in the air. So these patients, they inhale these spores and they get lost into the nasal cavity and into the sinuses. Spread from patient to patient or in the hospital is not there. I mean to say, from one patient to the next patient, mucormycosis does not spread. So we shouldn't be worried. In the hospital, they need not to be isolated as such. But definitely when we are discharging these patients who are diabetic, who have got a lot of steroids while in the hospital, we know pulse steroid therapy was very helpful in a subset of COVID-19 patients. The problem which has happened is many times these patients got exposure with steroids for too long. As per recommendation, it shouldn't be more than 10 days, that also in a low dose. But many physicians or at many places, the patient remained on steroids for very long time, especially diabetic patients, as it is Dr. Neil Thakkar has well explained, DKA or even diabetes, it causes low pH and it causes basically growth of mucormycosis. So definitely when we are sending our patients to home, they should be off steroids. They should be taught about that they may catch infection, so they should wear mask at home. Their bedrooms or washrooms should be cleaned. So these are the precautions which can be taken. Definitely all patients of post-COVID are not prone to infections. As I said, patients who are not diabetic, patients who are off steroids, they are relatively spared of these infections. If we see other infections in fungal infections in hospital, like Candida, definitely there is a spread. It can be a candidiasis, it can be a UTI, it can be a oral thrush, as Dr. Atri has well explained regarding white fungus. So that these are not very, very harmful. You can easily treat these candidiasis or simple candida infection in non-neutropenic patients with fluconazole. Like UTI, you need not to even treat this patient, just take out the Foley's catheter should be sufficient. So we should be very well aware which are the subset of patients who are prone to mucor, prone to aspergillus, prone to candida, and high index of suspicion is very, very important. The patient.
Thank you, Dr. Gurpreet. Thank you. The message is clear. So the next issue is to Dr. Neil Thakkar. You please address, what are the investigations to arrive at a diagnosis, the common investigation? And is it a simple invasion? How will you differentiate a simple invasion, a simple colonization from invasion? Dr. Neil Thakkar, please.
Yes. Sir, thank you for the question. So first of all, if any patient presents with a history of, like Dr. Gurpreet sir mentioned, regarding a history of chronic steroid use, or a patient is immunocompromised or a background with comorbidities. In the investigations, when we routinely see a patient in an outpatient, we would send some routine blood investigations that would include a complete blood count, a renal function test, a basic blood investigation. If a patient has a history of atopy, presenting with recurrent respiratory issues, whether the patient's IgE levels have been done previously, whether that patient has definitely a history of atopic asthma or any allergic tendency. Besides this, if for specifically for candidiasis, we would look clinically, like Dr. Atri sir and Dr. Gurpreet mentioned, that regarding oral thrush. So if the patient has any oral thrush, we should suspect. If and in such cases, other investigations such as a CT scan, a high resolution CT scan, would help us in differentiating with a history of fever, recurrent cough, where patient has taken some antibiotics, the patient's cough is not resolving, respiratory issues are not settling. At that time, we should think of fungal pneumonia. In a post-COVID state, as has been recurrently proven, that there are chances of a post-COVID secondary problem. Now, for the CT scan, I would like to share a couple of images first. As we have seen, if I may share my screen.
I think we can present it late actually, Neil Thakkar, because we have another around 10 more questions to discuss.
So just two slides of with the halo sign and the reverse halo sign. That's all.
Okay. In 1 minute, please.
Yes, sir. In 1 minute only. Is my screen visible, sir?
Yes.
So as we see that this is the first will be the radiology. This will be the reverse halo sign. Now this is the scene with mucormycosis when we describe the blood in the clinical features in the pulmonary radiology besides the PNS radiology. What we see is a reverse halo sign. In this, there is the alveolar septal inflammation and the cellular debris, which is seen in the center. And there is the granulomatous tissue with the distal airspaces seen in the periphery. So this is the distal, this is the reverse halo sign, which is again the most common condition to cause reverse halo in immunocompromised patients is mucormycosis. And besides this, in mucormycosis, we can have focal consolidation, nodules, effusion, mass, or an air crescent. Compared to that, in Candida or in Aspergillus, we have the halo sign. As we see here in this, the central portion is the nodular portion, surrounded by some ground glassing. So this is the halo sign. This is a, that way this can differentiate these two, that this is the reverse halo and this is the halo. This is an important differentiation which we can do to
thank you.
Yes,
thank you, doctor. Thank you, doctor. So the next issue is a big issue, actually a lot of questions in one setting. That it is to Dr. Atre. I think he can do justice to that. Can oxygen cylinders, humidifiers serve as a source for fungal spread? What is the role of hospital in a ventilatory system in spreading the disease? Do inadvertent use of sink in COVID patients? Many people are asking, sink in COVID, the use of sink in COVID patients favors the development of fungal pneumonias. A lot many questions, but I'm sure you can answer it in a very beautiful way, very simple language, please.
Fungal infections have taught us that excess of nothing is good. The classical example for the same is zinc. Zinc was given to everyone, to patient, to families. Even after discharge, zinc is sold over the counter. Many people come to me who had COVID last year, July, August, they are still taking zinc. So what happens? There is an acute phase reactant ferritin, which raises in the severe COVID and post-COVID. Ferritin is also known to promote the transport of iron and zinc in the body. Unfortunately, iron and zinc happen to be a very important growth factor for mucor and all these other naughty funguses. So too much of zinc protected our immunity and boosted the infectivity or growth factor of the fungus. So if you suspect black fungus, if the patient comes to me, oh, Dr. Saab, I am getting afraid of black fungus. Stop that zinc right now. Next thing, medical oxygen and industrial oxygen. The water used, the humidifier used, requires rigorous distillation, disinfection process. Any lapse in the disinfection distillation process can give rise to contamination. Just imagine a high flow oxygen, 70 liters per minute. That flow can drive the contaminated water very deep in the nasal cavity sinuses and the airway tracheobronchial tree. So why not? So wherever there was industrial oxygen replaced by medical oxygen with not a rigorous process of disinfection, distillation, definitely yes. Hospital linen and the ventilator circuit is very unlikely because maximum places they are disposed, discarded, not recycled. Also, the contamination of fungal is by deep contamination, not superficial contamination. So something which goes inside our noses, which something goes inside our mouth, throat, can cause more. So linen are external things. Vent system are external things. So less chances. But zinc, definitely yes. Industrial oxygen, definitely yes. Whenever the third wave hits, even if it does not hit, please keep surplus of medical oxygen and don't borrow, don't switch to industrial oxygen. Sir.
Thank you. So The next, thank you, you did it well actually. The next issue, what are the treatment options? Big issue, people are waiting for that. Please tell us the medical management of various fungal infection, Dr. Ashutosh, please.
Sir, the various treatment options, basically choice of fungal treatment will depend on clinical status of patient, the species of infecting organism, and our antifungal susceptibility profile of the infecting isolate, and the relative toxicity of different drugs, the presence of organ dysfunction that would affect drug clearance, and the patient prior exposure to antifungal agents. It's a very important parts before the applying antifungal drug for any species. In general, bloodstream infection of Candida, we start with the Candida. Albicans, Candida, Paracelsus, Candida, Tropicalis are treated with azoles, Echinocandins, and Flucytosine. Echinocandins preferably Caspofungin with a loading dose of 70 mg on day 1, followed by 50 mg per day, or Inudilafungin 200 mg IV OD on first day, followed by 100 mg OD, or Micafungin 100 mg IV OD. There is no loading dose required for Micafungin. Echinocandin is basically preferable for candidemia or candida infections. Fluconazole may be used in less critically ill patient or when drug is not available in a dose of loading dose of 12 mg per kg per day, followed by 400 mg or 6 mg per day. Lipid based formulation of amphotericin B at a dose of 3 to 5 mg per kg per day can be used for candidemia. When we talk about the invasive aspergillosis, the drug of choice is always oriconazole, the first choice. We will start with the 6 mg per kg IV dolavarli on day 1, followed by 4 mg per kg every dolavarli thereafter. Treatment can be transitioned to oral route as when patient is symptomatically better tolerating oral drugs. Treatment should be continued at least for 6 to 12 weeks. Polyenes are used in the treatment of invasive pulmonary aspergillosis in the setting of where leukermycosis remains a diagnostic dilemma. When there is difficult to differentiate, it is aspergillosis or it is leukermycosis, then it is better to start with liposomal amphotericin B because it covers both. Sometimes it is very difficult to differentiate between leuker as well as aspergillus. In this type of setting, we can start with the liposomal amphotericin B at a dose of 3 to 5 mg per kg per day. We can also use isavuconazole at the dose of 200 mg every 8 hourly for 6 doses, then 200 mg daily for invasive aspergillosis. When we now come with the leukermycosis, the most talked fungus like black fungus, we always start with the first choice, the liposomal amphotericin B, preferably with the dose of 5 to 10 mg per kg. We start with the 5 mg per kg per dose. But when we are suspecting the CNS involvement, then we should start with the 10 mg per kg liposomal amphotericin B. Treatment should continue, IV treatment should continue till the patient is resolving phase, and so radiologically clearing also. Then we can switch over to the oral drug, like oral isavuconazole, like 200 mg, or we can start with the, if amphotericin B is not available, we can start with the isavuconazole 300 mg, 200 mg 3 times a day for day 1 and 2. From 3rd day onward, we should continue with 200 mg per day from day 3rd. If these two drugs are not available, as we see in previous COVID pandemic, second wave COVID going on, we can start with the oral IV posaconazole, like 300 mg 2 times a day for day 1, then 300 mg per day from day 2. If anything is not available, we can also start with the suspension posaconazole. Suspension posaconazole, we can use with 200 mg 4 times a day per day. So it's the treatment chart of the leukermycosis. But we should see the response of the treatment. If patient is responding well with the IV, then we can switch over to the oral, like oral isavuconazole per oral, like 200 mg 3 times a day for day 1 and day 2, then 200 mg per day from day 3. Or we can also switch over to the oral posaconazole drug-release tablet, like 300 mg 2 times a day for day 1, then 300 mg per day since the treatment. depends on the clinical condition of the patient, depend on the clinical condition response of the treatment.
Well said. Actually, it is very difficult to remember all these doses. Yes, schedule. Yes. I think CC should prepare a poster and supply to all so that we can put it in our ICUs.
Yes.
So the nowadays we know that liposomal amphotericin is in shortage in most of the places.
Yes.
Dr. Gurpreet, what you say? What are the other options? Suppose it is not available regarding amphotericin alone. Other options already been discussed by Ashutosh. Suppose liposomal amphotericin is not available, what will you do?
So if the renal function is not compromised, you can even use amphotericin B deoxycholate, that is a conventional amphotericin B in the dose of 0.7 milligram per kg body weight. We have to be careful that we are giving it in dextrose solution over 6 to 8 hours, not in the electrolyte solution, because that will cause problem. You have to watch definitely the renal function of the patient regularly. That is important. These drugs, they can cause rigors, fevers, chills. So the better is to give pethidine to these patients beforehand. Most of the time, your paracetamol or antihistamines, they do not work in preventing the rigors for these patients. Even if we are thinking that give a hydrocortisone to these patients, this actually may be harmful. A patient is already having fungal infection. Giving them hydrocortisone may be a harmful thing. So pethidine is the drug of choice to give them beforehand so that you can prevent these types of reactions. Then you have lipid emulsion, which has come in recent times. But if we see the literature of lipid emulsion, basically it was for
Leishmaniasis.
And the penetration of this drug is mainly in the liver and spleen. So there are no studies which document that this drug can be used in sinus, rhinocerebral, or in pulmonary mucormycosis. We have actually used lipid emulsion when the amphotericin B was in shortage. And most of the time we have seen reactions, especially high-grade fever and rigors with this drug. We have actually given this drug for 4 to 6 weeks. Whenever we could get liposomal, we have used liposomal. In between, when the drug was not available, we have used lipid emulsion. The other choice can be a lipid complex amphotericin B. The dose of that is a little on lower side, that is 3 to 5 milligram per kg body weight. But that is also a drug which can be used. So any sort of amphotericin B, if it is available, should be used. And in these circumstances, in pandemic, when these drugs were in shortage, we have added posaconazole. We know posaconazole takes almost 1 week's time to achieve static concentration. So if we are suspecting a deficiency of amphotericin B in the market, we may use posaconazole in addition to amphotericin B to tide over this time. In this way, you can save definitely lives.
That's okay, sir. One question, sir. What about the preloading with the normal saline in case of amphotericin deoxycholate? Preloading and afterloading with the saline?
That is not required. You can just be sure that patient is well hydrated. Patient is not dehydrated. His creaturea is okay. His uric acid is okay. We can actually see the volume status of the patient with the IVT and other clinical
parameters. All right, sir, you said it. So the next issue is that the safety profile and also a lot of drug interactions with these kind of agents. So Dr. Neel Thakkar, please enlighten us on drug interactions and safety issues with regard to antifungals.
Thank you, sir. So with respect to the safety profile, first, as a few of the reactions sir had mentioned, that with infusions, especially if we are using a peripheral rind, there are chances that there will be nausea, there will be vomiting, there will be chills, rigors. If the patient has a chances of thromboflebitis are very high, in such cases, what we can do for these infusion site reactions is we can try using multiple different IV lines, larger bore lines if we are not using a central line. Avoid an infusion time of less than 4 hours. So we should ideally give at least for a period more than 4 hours. And as he rightly mentioned, pethidine is a good option compared to paracetamol and other agents. Second, the main reaction which we are concerned about is nephrotoxicity with amphotericin B. So there are two mechanisms. One is tubular injury and one is renal vasoconstriction. It causes a reversible but a transient decline in the glomerular filtration rate. And normally this is increased nephrotoxicity if the patient is either on a diuretic or severely dehydrated or is taking any other nephrotoxic drugs such as an aminoglycoside or any cyclosporin, any other nephrotoxic drugs. And the amphotericin B conventional is much more nephrotoxic than the lipid formulation. So two ways by which we can reduce the nephrotoxicity with amphotericin B is one is using lipid formulations. Now lipid formulations, how do they decrease the risk? Because number one, they do not contain deoxycholate and that has direct renal tubular toxicity. And liposome as a carrier are distributed in the reticular endothelial system where amphotericin B can be directly to the trapped fungi. And there is less distribution to the cholesterol containing cells which are normally present in the kidney. And second, as sir had asked previously, that sodium chloride loading. Now there is less literature or recent data with respect to MPOB associated nephrotoxicity. But one of the techniques in absence of contraindications is loading before the amphotericin B injection with a 500 ml solution of 0.9% normal saline. So that is postulated, but again, we need more randomized controlled trials to show that it benefits or not. Other electrolyte abnormalities is hypokalemia, hypomagnesemia, and hyperchloremic acidosis, which are common with amphotericin B. Another very common effect which we see in a lot of patients is anemia. We see a drop in hemoglobin, sometimes without an absence of bleeding. So there is a chance of a normotropic, normocytic anemia, as well as severe leukopenia with amphotericin B. So whenever we start this drug, we should look out for infusion reactions, monitor the renal function test as well as CBC. And in drug interactions, we have to make sure number one is nephrotoxic drugs. Number two is digoxin. Any patient who is receiving digoxin or any muscle relaxants is predisposed to its toxicity because of the enhanced effect of amphotericin B induced hypokalemia. And other thing is that some patients, very rare effect is that amphotericin B can cause an acute pulmonary reaction if there is a concomitant whole blood transfusion or a leukocyte transfusion. So in any such transfusions, we should be more cautious.
Thank you. Yes. So the next question is to Dr. Atre. When we should send a patient to ENT specialist in a suspected case of mucormycosis? Your friend Dr. Rubesh is sitting nearby. You please careful while answering. Because the next question is to him only.
We should remember, it is not my patient, it is not his patient, but if we treat the patient will bring more patient. The treatment for fungus infection involves multidisciplinary partnership, and there is a very big role of intervention in getting the tissue for diagnosis. So why not a transnasal sinus specimen, which can be easily taken compared to much more difficult specimens? And if we diagnose something, why not consult the surgeon immediately? Because in mucor, if we read any standard textbook, surgery comes before medicine. So if I am suspecting fungus, I have to refer to my ENT colleague that, boss, can you take a specimen from here for early diagnosis? And at the same time, can you do some wonderful debridement for the same? So that would be my point of referring to this ENT gentleman. If necessary, we both should simultaneously see the patient. Means when he or she would be doing that procedure, I should be standing nearby and not on the telephone.
Beautiful answer. So please, Dr. Rubesh, please add on to it. What is the role of CTPNS and MRI in the diagnosis of mucormycosis? Please enlighten us.
CTPNS and MRI is very useful in the diagnosis, sir. MRI is basically used for all the soft tissues where the invasion is there. And CT scan is mainly for the bony window where we look. The bony window which we look is for the erosion of the bone as well as any osteomyelitic changes in the bone, but we don't know the etiology. We can see only the osteomyelitic change and erosion. The second thing, it may be because of extensive mucormycosis, or it may be because of viral induced osteomyelitis, which is very less literature of that thing, viral induced. The MRI is very important to assess the invasion. So I repeatedly go to the radiologist to assess the MRI. MRI is very important in diagnosing and differentiating the vasculitis from invasive mucormycosis. How come then T1 weighted gadolinium enhanced or contrast enhanced MRI? It will enhance the meninges very well. But the mucor, specifically if mucor is there, and if there is a meningeal enhancement is less, then definitely it will percolate the meninges and into the brain parenchyma also it can be seen. But very, very less patients, no patients at all I have seen. All the patients have mainly middle cranial fossa dural enhancement, post-contrast dural enhancement in an MRI. And this lead me to the conclusion that enhancement is there and optic nerve sheath, dural enhancement, post-contrast is there, and hyperintensin T2 weighted imaging. So these discussion with the radiologist is very, very, very important to reach to the conclusion that is there is a mucor invasion in the orbit? Is there a mucor invasion in the cavernous sinus? Is there mucor invasion to the dura, to the brain, or some enhancement, means some inflammation is there? So the total management plan depend on these and the clinical finding during surgery. During surgery, when we operate, we have to look the contour of the mucosa, how it behaves, whether it is a clear classical mucormycosis or it is a vasculitis case. So all cases which we have operated for, we have seen a clear vasculitis and clear necrosis, which is not classical of mucor or any other fungus. And once we send it for real PCR test, the DNA of HSV is positive. On that basis, as well as on the antibody basis, we start both antifungal and antiviral on that basis. And rapidly the epithelializations comes. So this give me the conclusion that this virus is causing herpes activation from the ganglion, either infection primary or reactivation from the ganglion, which is travel to a particular dermatomal plane. And that's why the patient is suffering from the peculiar presence of these things, means cavernous sinus involvement, superior ophthalmic vein involvement, and infraorbital nerve involvement, because it's a branch of maxillary P2. And very few patients is from mandibular harm. Few patients, again, after recovering from all the things, presented with severe trismus, which I have already told. I have not given any medications. I have just given acyclovir injections to the patient, and the patient trismus has completely 80% gone in 5 days, sir. In 5 days, trismus has gone, and whatever the swelling is there in the supraorbital region, that is because of thromboembolism, thrombophlebitis, it has decreased. That give me the conclusion that virus, probably HSV, either due to infection or reactivation, is reaching to the adventitia of the blood vessels, and from there it is causing a inflammation, means vasculitis. It's a vessel inflammations, either it's a small artery, it's a maxillary artery, or it's an internal carotid artery. Means adventitia is involved, and it is responsible for release of D-dimer or blood clot protein. D-dimer that is responsible for the raised titer in spite of treating all the things. Once I started acyclovir and not giving any medications, no steroid, no antibiotic, nothing, D-dimer is decreasing. CRP has reduced to normal level within 4 to 5 days. And this is happening to most of the people.
Thank you. So one more question to you actually. What are the surgical aspects of treatment? Anyway, we are not going to do surgery. Don't worry about that. Then another question is that we heard that you had a lot of experience in the antifungal institution sinuses. Please elaborate on that too.
So antifungal, I have not able to use much because of the financial constraint of the patient. Amphotericin I have used in most of the patient, amphotericin liposomal. But this patient has received 7 to 10 days of total injectable liposomal amphotericin, or some patient with plain amphotericin, means a deoxycholate. Because of the nephrotoxicity, I have to discontinue it and put the patient on posoconazole 300 milligrams BD on day one, and then from 300 milligram OD, or sometime if patient is not able to tolerate, 100 milligram twice daily in divided dose. So the patient is able to take it for 7 to 10 days, but not able to maintain continuity because of unavailability and the expense also. But after follow-up of 10 to 15 days or after month, the patient has no sign of any mucosa. They have not taken any antifungal continuously for more than 2 weeks to 3 weeks. But there is no sign of mucor. Crusting is decreasing. Post secretion is decreasing from the bone. Osteomyelitic changes is decreasing. So my main concern here is the patient is not taking regularly. In spite of telling to take the drug, the patient is not following completely. Most of the patient, few patient has taken the injectable, but the recovery is complete with complete mucolization and epithelization of the sinuses, all sinuses, after taking antiviral, not after taking antifungal for even for a month. Even for a month, they have taken the antifungal, but the sinus mucolization is not coming properly with oroenteral fistula, because some maxillary bone, anterior, alveolar bone necrotic has been debrided by maxillofacial surgeon. All patient has developed, sir, enteral oral fistula with complete scarring of the mucosa. Those patients who has been taken care from initial point with acyclovir, their complete epithelialization is complete with no oroenteral fistula in those patients. That we will take care of all the records and we will publish it soon, sir.
Okay. So the next, we are now coming to the prognostic aspects. Dr. Neel Thakkar, give us some idea on the general prognosis and factors affecting prognosis.
Thank you, sir. So first of all, whenever there is a patient with a post-COVID or a mucormycosis in general, the first thing is we have to start with explaining a guarded prognosis, irrespective, because initially there are a number of individual factors, but the overall prognosis in mucormycosis is poor. So we are going to treat the patient aggressively with intravenous antifungals. We are going to operate where needed. We are going to salvage whatever portion possible. But in this case, first sign has to be a guarded prognosis, has to be explained. Patients with a chronic kidney disease, with chronic renal failure, patients who have had a disseminated infection, that is not only rhino-orocerebral, even pulmonary, with that a disseminated involvement, have a poor prognosis. And specifically, if a patient is taking any pre and perioperative antifungal, that has been shown by recent data as well as previous data that there is significant improvement if a patient is perioperatively on a good appropriate antifungal therapy that has improved outcomes. And patients with a delayed diagnosis, the presence of bilateral sinus involvement, underlying blood malignancy, a renal failure, these all are patients which are associated with a higher mortality. And the mortality is worse when there is lung involvement. Overall, only when there is rhino-orbital or cerebral mucormycosis, the mortality is around 40, mortality is around 40% in such cases. And when it is also involving pulmonary, it is around 60%. That is as per whatever data is published with respect to mucormycosis, not with specifically to post-COVID or COVID-associated mucormycosis, but in general.
Thank you. So the next issue, COVID will be here and naturally post-COVID too. So Dr. Atri, what are the measures we should take to prevent the occurrence of fungal pneumonias? Anyway, there will be COVID, there will be post-COVID. Tell us, please.
First, we need to identify and demarcate who are the highest risk people. Please remember this sentence, dear audience. Transplantation invites plantation. Anyone who had transplantation suffers COVID will be at the highest risk for plantation or fungal. Next, any diabetes, suspect diabetes, family history of diabetes, borderline diabetes will be a suspect. Anyone with transplant, be careful. Anyone with a hint of diabetes, have your personal diabetologist. You shall be protected. Otherwise, there is no hard and fast rule. We have seen lots of diversity, but the most common things isolated, mind you, from India, I am not talking about international data, has always incriminated these two certain categories. So next wave comes, profile your patients from before, that if you are in these two categories, we have to be more careful with you. And yes, if we have incriminated zinc, then stay away from zinc. I think ICMR has now in fact discouraged the use of zinc also.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. So now, is there any role for vaccines? Is there any vaccines under development for these fungal infections? And another issue is that is the vaccines for COVID will prevent the occurrence of developing fungal infections in future? Dr. Hiranappa, please enlighten us on that.
We don't have vaccines for fungal infections as such. And the COVID vaccine itself, the COVID is the most important risk factor for a development of a mucor. That itself is a risk factor, apart from the steroid and other things. When the height of COVID infection, most of the time we see mucor and fungal infections post-COVID, but it can happen during the COVID. The immune suppression it causes by virus itself is so much, they are more susceptible to secondary bacterial infection and fungal infections. As such, COVID vaccinations will decrease the occurrence of COVID and COVID complications. That itself can have an indirect effect that they should not have a more and more fungal infections. And definitely vaccination has decreased in the number of COVID cases, has seen a decreased number of mucor mycosis also, that we have seen in India. So I feel vaccination can indirectly help in decreasing the number of COVID cases, because the treatment required, treatment complications, COVID complications will always decrease the risk of having the fungal infections. So vaccinations for COVID will protect, for apart from COVID, have an extensive role that it can protect from fungal infection, because you are not getting the complications of COVID and you are not affected with the COVID itself.
Thank you. So I am happy to announce right now that we have crossed 1,300 logins for this webinar. Very good achievement. Thank you all the participants. And now we have some few other questions. I think we have covered almost all the areas, and we have a lot many questions answered by the participants have asked many questions. Many are in the chat box. But before that, Dr. Neil Thacker, what is the role of biomarkers in the diagnosis of invasive fungal infection? For example, galactomannan and beta-1,3-D, gluconease, etc., etc. Please brief and please tell us.
Yes, sir. I'll try to be as brief as possible.
Yeah, thank
First
you.
First would be galactomannan. It's a polysaccharide and a major constituent in the Aspergillus cell walls. Now, normally, whenever we see a report of galactomannan, we will see there is a OD index. That's the optical readout index. The importance of this is that mostly the FDA has approved 0.5 as the cutoff for galactomannan. So any galactomannan which is higher than 0.5 as per the FDA, that would be on the higher side. Now, whatever, whenever we are interpreting the report of galactomannan, we have to be sure that, number one, it is most accurate if the patient is immunocompromised. Number second is the patient has a hematologic malignancy or who has a post bone marrow transplant patient. These three are the most, where it is the most accurate. Caution is that if a patient has been on any empirical antifungal therapy, then we have to know that galactomannan, the report, the sensitivity will decrease. If the patient has been already on any other antifungal, then the sensitivity is less. If a patient is on any beta-lactam antibiotic, such as piperacillin tazobactam or any other beta-lactam antibiotic, there is a chance that it can give a false positive result. And again, the so we any patient with a graft versus host disease, that also is likely to give a false positive result. Now, from whatever data there is before COVID, patients with persistent positive galactomannan results were more likely to die. So the chances of mortality of a patient with an invasive fungal infection as a persistent positive serum galactomannan, it was shown in 2008 in the Clinical Infectious Disease Journal that it is likely to increase the overall bad prognosis. Second, before specifically with respect to COVID, so recently there has been a new entity in aspergillosis also in the Intensive Care Medicine Journal, which has been published in August 2020. That there is the entity which is COVID-associated pulmonary aspergillosis. So in that now, galactomannan is included as a criteria for defining COVID-associated aspergillosis. So any patient will be having a probable COVID-associated aspergillosis if he has pulmonary infiltrates with a serum galactomannan index more than 0.5 or a bile galactomannan index more than 1 or a positive bile culture. So galactomannan is now important to define even in absence of culture. Culture is proven. Histopathology is proven COVID-associated aspergillosis. Even influenza-associated aspergillosis, there is a new term, probable COVID-associated aspergillosis and influenza-associated aspergillosis, which can be defined by the aspergillus, the galactomannan index. Also, so this is with respect to galactomannan. And in cases where with COVID-19, it has been shown that there was a study which was published in July 2020 for the epidemiology of invasive pulmonary aspergillosis in intubated patients with COVID-19. Now, that showed that the odds of death within 30 days of hospitalization increased to 1.4-fold by each point increase in the bile galactomannan index. So that would show what is the importance of this biomarker if it is done. This study was done on around 108 patients with all samples were tested with a bile galactomannan, and it helped in prognosticating that the bile galactomannan index was independently associated with an increased odds of death within 30 days of hospitalization. This is with respect to galactomannan. Coming to beta-D-glucan, it is again a cell wall component of many fungi, and it is measured by the beta-D-glucan assay. The value is normally negative, indeterminate, or positive. Positive is more than 80, indeterminate is 60 to 80. Now, the diagnosis for invasive fungal infections, the pooled sensitivity of beta-D-glucan is around 77%, and pooled specificity is around 85%. This is from a meta-analysis done in 2011. And again, this shows that, again, we should not be taking any one biomarker only on its value. We should look at the background of the illness. However, in beta-D-glucan, they found that before it was grown on cultures, the beta-D-glucan started to rise in the blood. So its utility in diagnosing invasive fungal infections early, it is being researched as an early biomarker for identifying specifically invasive candida infections as well as aspergillus infections. But more likely, it has a very high negative predictive value for mucormycosis. So in patients with this typical...
Thank you, doctor. The message is clear. There are hundreds of residents, maybe thousands are hearing this webinar. Sure. So a very important question on the point of discuss something about azoles and what is any superiority over the newer azole, isavuconazole. Dr. Ashutosh, please.
We know that the antifungal triazoles are commonly called azoles. The most widely used azoles are fluconazole, itraconazole, osaconazole, and oriconazole. The newer is isoconazole. These agents act basically on fungal cell membrane by inhibiting cytochrome P450 dependent demethylase. The azoles act both fungistatic or fungicidal depending on specific azole and fungal species. It also shows some immunomodulatory effects. Like fluconazole used in the treatment of candidiasis, cryptococcal meningitis, and prophylaxis for patient undergoing hematopoietic stem cell transplant patient who received cytotoxic chemotherapy or radiotherapy. The major adverse effect for fluconazole is alopecia, diarrhea, nausea, vomiting, sometimes hepatotoxicity also there. Itraconazole basically has little role in opportunistic fungal infection, but we are using it for the ABPA. The major side effects are adrenal insufficiency when used on long-term basis, or CHF. We should use itraconazole usually not use itraconazole in CHF patients or in cardiac patient, because it causes CHF, it causes QT prolongation, and some hepatotoxic effect also there for itraconazole. Posaconazole used in the basically oropharyngeal candidiasis, especially refractory to fluconazole or itraconazole. We can also are using posaconazole in mucormycosis with a dose of 200 mg 4 times a day. Oriconazole, we all know that is drug of choice for the invasive aspergillosis or candidiasis. Major side effects are usual disturbances, prototoxicity. Even long-term use for oriconazole can lead to skin cancers, especially squamous cell cancer. Isavuconazole is the newer modality in the azoles. It is basically approved for the use of invasive aspergillosis and invasive mucormycosis only, not for other use in adult. And advantage is isavuconazole has fewer side effects as compared to oriconazole, including less hepatotoxicity and less visual disturbance.
Thank you. Dr. Gurpreet.
Shahjahan, very shortly, one line. Remember, when the pathogen behaves like an ASS-OLE, the drug of choice is either AZOLE.
Thank you.
Yes.
Very, very good. Nice observation. Dr. Gurpreet, what are the echinocandins in clinical usage? Your group of drugs. You please elaborate.
Echinocandins already discussed. We have caspofungin, we have mycofungin, we have anidulafungin. All three are almost equal. There is not much difference. Definitely patients who are neutropenic with candidiasis, with candidemia, the drug of choice is one of the echinocandins. Caspofungin is, you know, is a cheaper, but patients who are having some renal dysfunction, hepatic dysfunction, probably the drug of choice could be anidulafungin. Otherwise, there are not much differences in these drugs. The importance of echinocandin is that if you are suspecting anything in the brain or in the eye or in the urine, echinocandins, they do not penetrate CNS, they do not penetrate eye, and the concentration in urine is also very low. But it has been seen that if the patient is critically sick, even with UTI, you may have to use echinocandins if the renal function is not normal, because in those cases, you can't use even amphotericin B. So these are some of the things which are important. And some of the candida, they are by nature, they are resistant to azoles, like Candida, Glabrata, Cruzii. Here again, the drug of choice is echinocandin. But if you have a patient with Candida glabrata who is susceptible to the sensitivities to the voriconazole, you can use voriconazole. We have seen in the literature also, in our hospital also, especially in COVID-19 patients, we have seen Candida auris, which is again a healthcare associated candidiasis or candidemia. We have grown in blood culture Candida auris, and here again the drug of choice is echinocandin. Most of the Candida auris, they are resistant to other drugs like amphotericin B or fluconazole. So it is important, if you isolate an organism like Candida auris, the drug of choice is echinocandin. Most of the time, they may be resistant to echinocandins also. But this is what we have. So depending upon availability, financial thing, the echinocandins can be used interchangeably in between caspofungin, mycofungin, or anidulafungin.
Thank you. And also, we should realize one thing, that voriconazole has no role in the treatment of mucormycosis. Many a time, people are using it. The only available agent is that, so people are using that, of no use at all. In the initial introduction itself, I discussed about the high incidence of mucormycosis in India. In fact, 80% of the cases are from India, and the prevalence is 80 times higher. Atre, could you explain why in India, why not in other countries?
Polypharmacology in India anyone can prescribe and almost everyone can administer. Often, where I work, I get patient maybe as the fourth or fifth consulting person, out of which the first one is almost universally a non-doctor. And due to polypharmacology, injudicious use of steroid, followed by multiple uses of immunomodulators. I have seen people being given ulinastatin, bevacizumab, baricitinib, tablet steroid and injectable steroid and nebulized steroid all at the same time. And then COVID se bach gaya, but kuch aur ho gaya. So polypharmacology and non-health practitioners can be a very big reason for us being the Mucor capital of the world. I seriously don't think that overpopulation has any role in this. I seriously don't think. Because if it would be overpopulation, then it would be contagious. But I am sure all of us here agree that it is not contagious. So this is one thing which we need to work with, maybe partnership of community health practitioners, PSM people, and administration.
Okay, thank you. Now I think we have covered almost all the questions put there by the panelists and myself. I think we can now discuss some questions what the our esteemed delegates put it in the chat box. The first, I will read it out. Dr. Arpita Sarkar asked, she's from West Bengal, white fungus, we eat those mushrooms, isn't it? Asking white fungus. Actually, white fungus is candidiasis. It is not the white fungus eat mushroom. It's different, actually. Am I correct? So there is, it is not, it is simply candid. It is a misnomer. We only use as a research because it is a common practice among the public. We also use that. That's all. So the next question is that Trichosporon ashi septicemia in post-COVID patient, sensitivity to amphotericin B only. How common this fungal infection in COVID cases? Presently, I am treating one patient. That is from Suresh Mittal from Delhi. Anyone, please.
You Trichosporon ashi septicemia. This is something very rare. You must report this case. Trichosporon septicemia is something very rare. If I go by the textbook, I know only amphoB will hit here. Other things, I don't think it will hit here. But you should report this case. Very rare.
Yes. If galactomannan assay is negative, can we exclude aspergillosis? Obviously, no. Am I correct? Obviously, no. Because we need to have a battery of evaluation. Obviously, no.
How long... There is one study here with relevance to this question. In whatever literature I was reviewing, that the negative predictive value compared, like there is sensitivity, specificity, and negative predictive value. So it does have a higher negative predictive value compared to the positive one. So it does help in ruling out, but it does not mean that a negative galactomannan means nahi hoga. But it has a negative predictive value of galactomannan assay is higher than the positive predictive value for serum assays. Yes, sir.
Okay. Then next is how long should posaconazole be continued? How long posaconazole be continued?
Depends on the infection.
Based on
the clinical condition. There is no clear cut guidelines of how much time we can use.
Yeah.
Depends on the clinical condition of the patient.
That is true actually. Okay. The next question people are asking is about dose of acyclovir and duration of treatment. I think we have already discussed. Please, Dr. Rupesh, please. Dose of acyclovir. Anyone? Dose of acyclovir and duration of treatment.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Acyclovir is to be start only when you have a confirmation on immunological basis as well as have a biopsy confirmation also, so as to confirm the patients also, because patient want confirmation that why you are giving this medications, I have never read anything. So you have to require a confirmation along with the sign and symptom also. You can't give any medication without sign, symptom and confirmation, number one. Number two, it should show improvement in the patient's symptoms. On that basis, you have to give. So my basis of giving the acyclovir depend on the duration of the improvement, depending on the improvement of the patients or regarding breathlessness, regarding regarding local improvement, local mucolizations, decreasing of the pus. So the duration depend on that thing. Most commonly, I use acyclovir twice to thrice daily, depend on the nerve condition involved, for 14 days. If patient have a lot of issues regarding intravenous that I am not able to take, then I have to give oral valcyclovir, 1 gram TDS. If there is ophthalmoplegia, 1 gram TDS for at least 10 to 15 days. Yeah, then one up to 21 days also. But I have not given till 21 days. I have given up to 10 to 14 days. And intravenous I will prefer because initially I have given, before giving injectable, I have given oral valacyclovir to all patients, but it has not given me improvement. Once I started intravenous, it has shown me a drastic improvement, like ptosis has decreased. Ophthalmoplegic patients, ptosis has decreased. Medial rectus, inferior rectus, superior oblique muscle, in that order, the movement of the eyeball has started. And the patient's paresthesia of infraorbital nerve has come down. Only by after giving acyclovir, some patient has taken twice daily, 500 milligram in 100 ml normal saline, 200 ml normal saline IV, slowly for 1 hour. And few patients has taken for 3 times who are admitted in our hospital for a long term of 10 days.
Thank you. And another question from Dr. M.K. Matnani from Uttar Pradesh. The CNS manifestations of fungal infection, when to doubt and how to confirm?
CNS
manifestation of fungal infection, when to doubt and how to confirm?
CNS manifestations here,
there is headache of two things. There is
headache. Okay, absolutely.
Carry on.
First is, the fungus is causing the CNS manifestation. Second is what we are seeing after amphotericin B, the treatment is causing the CNS manifestation. I think all of you agree.
Very good.
Yeah. Chest infiltrates, not resolving to antibiotics, with headache, diplopia, documented immune suppression, especially neutropenia. There has to be something CNS fungal manifestation. It can be candidiasis. It can be cryptococcosis. The others are not so much, like aspergillus is not so much noted. Mucor basically goes by direct spread, so it is late. But candida, cryptococcus goes first over there. So that is the CNS manifestation due to the fungus. CSF study, classical Indian ink preparation we used to do in our that internship, which used to diagnose that cryptococcus. If you get CNS manifestation cryptococcus, only thing you can give is Ampho-B. And if there is meningoencephalitis, I don't know whether it is available. However, I read in the textbook 5-fluorocytosine. I don't know whether it is available or not. Maybe oncology hospitals have it. And candida, the CNS treatment is same for disseminated candida. But in nowadays, when we are treating this mucor outbreak, please think of treatment-induced CNS manifestation first. Ashutosh sir, please add on to me.
Totally agree.
Okay, I will ask the next. I will give in the next question to Dr. Ashutosh. What is the ideal duration of treatment for mucormycosis and dose in chronic renal disease? That is from Dr. Karthik G from Mysuru, Karnataka.
There is no ideal duration of
treatment. Ideal. Very no difficult question.
Very difficult, and there is no ideal duration of treatment. It solely depends on the clinical condition, clinical resolution of the symptom, as well as radiological resolution of the symptom. It depends on the both, clinical resolution and radiological resolution of the mucormycosis.
Thank you.
I will just add on to this. As sure. Dr. Rupesh has said, if there is a good surgical debridement, then the duration could be very, very less also.
Yes.
As Dr. Rupesh has clearly shown, 50 of his patients have done very well with very little amphotericin B. I think the surgical debridement is a choice and you can decrease the duration of amphotericin B. Otherwise, definitely 4 to 6 weeks should be the treatment of choice. Regarding other infections, you have to be sure that after 2 weeks, the culture is negative, there is a symptomatic improvement, the sign and symptoms have gone down, then only you can stop antifungal drugs.
Thank you. And the next question, I think we have already discussed this, preventive strategies with regard to fungal infections. Dr. Madhav Kulkarni from Karnataka is asking, we already discussed. We'll go to the next question. Steroid is blamed for fungal infection, but treatment of aspergillosis involves giving steroid. Please clarify. Steroid is a double-edged sword. We all know that. Please clarify. Please clarify. Panelists, please clarify.
Aspergillus is peculiar fungus, you know, it's mucor, we don't give steroids.
Yeah, yeah.
We don't give steroids. And this fungus is requiring steroids. And why we are doing that? So there is a two components to it. There is an infection and inflammatory component. So most of the time, if you feel that it is like wheezing and this kind of manifestation, it's very difficult to differentiate clinically. So if you have a asthmatic patients and these kind of patients, it's more common. Asthma and aspergillus, they go hand in hand most of the time. So if these kind of patients, steroid is required. If they are non-asthmatics or non-atopic, or if they have a no fungal sensitization, I don't think steroid is required, only antifungals are required.
Next question we already addressed, but people are asking, maybe some confusion. What is the difference between emulsion and liposomal form of amphotericin? Emulsion and liposomal form of amphotericin. I think Dr. Gurpreet is discussing that, please.
You're muted.
Yeah. Actually, there are different formulations. Liposomal definitely is the best one with least aflatoxicity. That is liposomal amphotericin B. The emulsion form is basically oil in water emulsion. It's basically what they have used is a soybean oil with some water and other ingredients to make it like a emulsion. Lipid is basically intralipid, 20% lipid along with amphotericin B, and deoxycholate is a plain one. So these are different formulations. And as Dr. Neil Thakkar has clearly told us, the nephrotoxicity depends upon deoxycholate as well as the active moiety. And when you are combining it with the liposomes or lipid, basically the concentration of amphotericin B in the blood, it becomes very less and it concentrates into the tissues, mostly lungs, liver, spleen. So that is how you can decrease the toxicity of these drugs.
Okay, sir. Another interesting question from our president, Honorable President Dr. Devi Doshi. Who will answer that question? Is black fungus also a Chinese agent? Who will answer that question?
We don't know exactly.
Anyone can answer. I will not answer that question.
Something of suspicion actually remains because rheumatologists have been using steroids for decades. 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, no black fungus, no any fungus. Then all of a sudden, if someone is getting antifungal for 10 days, how did this person develop black fungus? There is a point of doubt, point of suspicion over here, which maybe requires a proper research. Maybe we are missing something. Maybe there can be some implantation. There can be some biological manipulation, because rheumatologists have been using steroid for two decades, three decades.
We are also using it. We are also using it like anything.
Yes.
Like anything. People are abusing steroids.
In sarcoidosis.
I just want to add on this.
Yeah, sure. Anyway, I want everybody's opinion on that.
Yeah, one thing is basically high index of suspicion. When we got a lot of mucor mycosis cases, the suspicion goes very high to all the clinicians, all the physicians who are treating these patients. As I have mentioned in my talk, most of these patients are pre-COVID. So definitely, as Dr. Neil Thakkar has established, has told many times, that it's basically an uncontrolled diabetes, DK. These patients are very, very prone to mucor, and mucor is there in the air. So in my view, putting it on China may not be relevant. It's basically, definitely the surge has gone up, the steroid abuse was there. Other thing is a high dose of steroid. You know, dexamethasone people have used beyond recommendation. The recommendation is 4 to 6 milligram, and people are using 20 mg, and that also for a long duration, 1 month, 1.5 months. Similarly, methylprednisolone pulse dose people have used 1 gram three days, and then goes down to 1 milligram per kg body weight. So abuse of steroid was definitely there. So it's only a comment. Maybe there are two things. One is uncontrolled diabetes patients who got COVID, they are already immunocompromised. The other thing is they have received so many of antibiotic also. The antibiotic abuse was also too high. So these are probably the factors which have contributed to high cases of mucormycosis. We have not seen high cases of mucormycosis in first wave. It has happened in second wave most of the time. I think all
I agree. Feel mucor is a organism which likes iron, it likes zinc, it needs acid pH. Yes. And normally the mucors are there in the sinus. That's what our ENT specialist says. Our sinus are filled with some fungus. It will be silent our immune so we create a system where you give steroids and they are uncontrolled. Even without steroids also we have seen mucor who are uncontrolled. So sugars, they need a good substrate of sugars. They need iron, esperoxinone treatment, iron, zinc. All this milieu will create a good growth medium for in the sinus and the airway. So that's why mucor takes a ride and it starts maybe germinating more and causes more
invasion. And sir, one more point here is regarding mucosal immunity also. Like in cases, there is one immunity which is the systemic one and one is the mucosal one. So in the second wave of COVID, we saw that a lot of times there is one major factor which is getting studied is steam. Like everybody is taking steam so much that there is a fall in the number of active goblet secreting cells. Second, there is also use of inhaled steroids. Now, whatever the Stoic trial as well as now the principal trial, which is still yet to publish, what we are seeing is inhaled steroids, sir. I'm saying inhaled steroid in the form is shown to have some benefit, but for patients on an outpatient basis in early COVID. But most of the times, what we find is sometimes patients are also discharged on steroids routinely, inhaled steroids, that you can have an inhaled steroid on discharge. So the right dose, the right time, and avoiding any misused steroid is also one factor. Steam and mucosal immunity also contribute to the rise in the mucor cases. Then.
So, thank you. Now,
just Dr. Antri, because you are talking about the oxygen and other things, I just read about hyperbaric oxygen therapy in mucor mycosis.
Yes, yes.
How exactly you correlate? You need one hand, oxygen is we giving more, it acts like a substrate, we're giving more oxygen, it will decrease mucus.
These are all double-edged swords. Actually, these are all double-edged swords. One way it will help you, and the other aspect it will destroy you. So we have to use it judicially. That is the message, actually. So right now we have crossed almost all the questions and a very fruitful discussion. Now we are at the end of the session. So I request all the panelists to have a take-home message in one sentence or at the maximum two sentences. So starting with Dr. Rubesh, what do you tell? What is your message?
My message to all the panelists like that, the mucormycosis is not a single entity. The entire body is suffering from some type of systemic disease. And that is to be looked. Every individual organ in which the sensory organ is involved, especially nose, that is the responsibility of the ENT doctor to identify the etiological factor, the main etiological factor, the why it is unilateral, why it is bilateral, and why there is a clear-cut necrosis, so as to correlate the disease systematically. So that Thank is you. A
okay. Okay. Yes, sir. Continue, doctor, please. Okay, then Dr. Ashutosh, one sentence.
Yeah, sir, not only steroid is responsible for the infection, fungal infection. It's COVID that is responsible for the emergence of fungal infection. Only steroid cannot be blamed.
Atribai.
Our patients, thanks to free internet, know more about COVID and fungus and they are more scared. So if you get a fungal case post COVID, please sit with them and try to listen to their fear issues and try to reinforce them that, see, this is new for you. This is also new for the medical community, but together we are going to fight it. We are going to beat it and you are going to be healthy.
High index of suspicion for fungal infections post COVID and during hospitalization of patient is very, very important. Second thing which I want to comment about oxygen is the PGA studies have established that probably it is a container, I mean to say the cylinders, yes, which were not in use, they were contaminated with mucor instead of the water, which was labeled as probably the source of infection. So in Delhi and in other states also, when the oxygen usage, oxygen was deficient, people have used the cylinders which were not in use without cleaning them. Probably that was also the source. Industrial oxygen as such, they say, is probably purer than the medical oxygen. So container has to be clean. I will just say general awareness about the fungal infection, as well as Dr. Atri said, the patient should also be aware that these things can happen. They shouldn't go to a sideway people to get the treatment, steroids and all. They should consult a physician who is well versed about the COVID.
Well said, sir. Dr. Hiranappa, please.
Don't treat your COVID in such a way that you require an antiviral drug at last for a viral disease. You need acyclovir for micromycosis. Don't treat the disease. Treat the disease like a disease. Don't see the CT. Don't see the inflammatory markers. You get the tempo of a disease for 14 days. Treat, under treat, people will improve. Over treating will end up in more problem. So my message is, don't get into a situation, treat a viral disease so you require no antiviral works now for viral disease. Now we are coming back to antiviral drug in a mucor. Don't get into that situation. It can be doctor made, it can be patient made. Use steroid judiciously.
Thank you. Now we will hear from Dr. Neil Thacker.
Sir, thank you so much. Sir, my message here would be that whenever we treat with secondary infection or COVID, there are things we can modify, there are things which we can't. The virus, the mutations, we can't modify that. What we can modify is that there is a principle in medicine, primum non nocere. We first do no harm. So that comes for the patient himself, the nursing staff, as well as the doctors, that any sort of over therapy. So we have to give minimal therapy what is needed, be it steroids, be it oxygen, be it ICU stay, be it unnecessary antibiotics. So minimal therapy and what is needed is the message I would like to convey. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, dear friends, for the excellent presentation. My job is lessened by your brilliant experience and your knowledge. Thank you. Thank you. And I should also thank the esteemed participants for the active interaction which made this panel discussion live and very active. And to conclude, maintaining euglycemia, judicious use of steroids, and above all, not getting COVID will help us not to be part of fungal holy. We could discuss the differences in epidemiological patterns, diagnostic dilemmas, therapeutic challenges, prognostic implications to great extent. Yet, the unanswerable issues are there. Only time can reveal the mycotic mystery fully. As of now, we cannot. So let us hope a world free of COVID and fungal holy will be a reality soon. Okay, stay safe, stay healthy. Good night. Thank you all once
thank
again.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Shahjah, sir, for the excellent moderation, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Shahjah, sir. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you, Gurpreet sir. Thank you.
Thank you.